Hello and welcome to our course Star and Planet Formation, lecture number 4. Today we will talk about stability of molecular clouds. The individual topics are listed on the right hand side. We will start with a section on the virial theorem. We will then look at under what conditions a gas cloud turns unstable, and look finally at a pressureless collapse of a cloud of gas. So let's start with the virial theorem. So far, when we derived the hydrodynamic and magnetohydrodynamic equations, we ignored gravity. Let's now take the MHD equations and leave out all the terms, including viscosity and resistivity, which we saw in the last lecture are unimportant on large scales. Anyway, then our MHD equations are the continuity equation, the equation of mass conservation, and the conservation of momentum equation. And in the second equation, we have here an additional term describing the strength of the gravity. Phi is the gravitational potential. So minus rho nabla phi is the gravitational force per unit volume. These are the Eulerian equations in their conservative form. To simplify them, we rewrite them in tensorial form, and for that we define two tensors, the fluid pressure tensor pi and the Maxwell stress tensor T. Here, the I tensor is the identity tensor. In tensor notation, the two can be given in this form, and with these newly defined tensors, we can write the momentum equation in a very simplified form, where we combine the first three terms here in these two tensors. This is possible because of vector calculus identities. So the curl of B, curl B, can be written here with this permutation tensors. And they give us a way to rewrite the cross products here in terms of the divergence. I suggest that you try to follow through the individual steps, and for that I give you here in the lecture notes the important definitions, for example, of the epsilon permutation symbol, the Kronecker's, of course, and different products of the permutation vectors. With that, you should be able to redo the steps here to follow through the derivation. We will skip that here and just take the simplified form. Now let's imagine that we have a gas cloud that is enclosed in some fixed volume V. The surface of this cloud is S, and one way to specify how the overall distribution of mass inside the volume changes is by writing down the moment of inertia, which is the volume element of rho times r squared. The change of the moment of inertia over time I over dt, or E dot, can be written like this. And we can replace the partial derivative here with the Naplan operator and then expand the derivative by pushing the r inside the parenthesis, so having basically the inverse of the product rule. And in the first step, we apply the divergence theorem to replace the volume with the surface integral. Here the S indicates the surface integral and the V the volume integral. The second time derivative with an additional factor 1.5 can be computed from this solution then. So we have again the surface and the volume integral, and we note that this term here can be then replaced also with our momentum equation. We replace everything and we get here the expression for the second derivative. Now, conveniently, for any tensor T, the following is always true. If we have here the vector integral of a vector r times the divergence of t, this can be written with these two integrals, where we have the surface integral of r dot t dot ds minus the volume integral of the trace of t, so the diagonal elements. And for the pi vector, for the pi tensor, the trace is simply 3 times the pressure plus rho times velocity squared. And the trace of Tm is given by the magnetic field strength squared divided by 8 pi negative. So when we insert this into the second derivative, we finally reach the full virial theorem, which is given as 1/2 of the second derivative, time derivative of the moment of inertia is 2 times t minus ts plus b plus w minus the surface integral 1/2 rho v vector r squared, and taking the time derivative of this expression. Here we added some additional abbreviations, some definitions. So t is given by the volume integral of 1/2 rho velocity squared plus 3/2 p, which is just the total kinetic energy in our cloud plus the thermal energy of the cloud. So T is the full kinetic energy. Ts is defined with the pi tensor here, and it's basically the confining pressure on the cloud surface, including thermal pressure and REM pressure, that is pressure of any gas flowing through the surface from the inside to the outside or from the outside to the inside. So that's the surface term. Then B is just the difference between the magnetic pressure in the cloud interior, which stabilizes our cloud against collapse, and the magnetic pressure plus the magnetic tension at the cloud surface, which is trying to collapse our cloud. And finally, W is the gravitational energy of the cloud, so the gravitational binding energy, plus possibly some external gravitational field overlaid over the internal gravitation. The term at the end here is, when we look at this, this is the rate of change of momentum flux across the cloud surface. I dot dot is the integrated form of the acceleration. So for a cloud of a fixed shape, it tells us the rate of change of the cloud's expansion or contraction. Consequently, is if I dot dot is zero, zero acceleration means our cloud is stable. If I dot dot is negative, then that means that all the terms in our virial theorem that are trying to collapse the cloud are larger and the cloud accelerates inward. If I dot dot is positive, the terms that favor expansion are larger and the cloud accelerates outward. If we now assume that we have no gas crossing the cloud surface, therefore there is no exchange of kinetic energy, so we have a velocity of zero at the surface, and we have a uniform magnetic field, B naught, at the surface, the virial theorem simplifies to this equation, where the Ts simplifies to just the surface integral of R times the pressure, and B is here the difference between the uniform magnetic field and the internal magnetic field strength. So again, Ts is just the mean radius times the pressure at the surface, the virial surface, and B represents the total magnetic energy of the cloud minus the magnetic energy of the ambient background field. If we now assume equilibrium, so we set the left-hand side to zero, and if we assume that all the forces on the surface and all the magnetic forces are for the moment negligible, we just have the very simple form of the virial theorem that you might recall from other lectures, which states that in equilibrium, 2 times the kinematic energy equals the negative potential energy. We can now define the virial ratio, which is just the ratio of 2t over absolute value of w, and according to our equilibrium condition, this implies if this alpha is 1, then we have equilibrium exactly. If alpha is larger than 1, then this means we have higher kinetic energy, which favors again expansion. If it's smaller than 1, then we have higher potential energy, and there is not sufficient kinetic energy to expand our system.